Good morning, all of you, and thanks, Aalt, for introducing me, and hello to everyone who's here in the audience. I'd like to start my presentation with a quiz. How many times do you think every day people consume a PepsiCo product? I hear some numbers here, but indeed, the answer is over a billion. Every day, across the globe, more than 1 billion people, more than 1 billion servings of PepsiCo products are being consumed here daily. So that's basically the equal to every man or woman or child in China eating at least one serving of a PepsiCo product at breakfast or lunch or snack or with a dinner. And I know you are familiar with our products, but now let me tell you also a little bit more about the company. We are a global diversified food and beverage company and the biggest player in the US and one of the largest globally after Nestle, as you just heard. We have about $66 billion every year in revenue, and over 280,000 people work with the company, and we sell our products in over 200 countries. There's even more countries than the United Nations has members. But do you really know the company, PepsiCo? Our fun for you snacks, probably, and the treats and the carbonated beverages, they made us a household name. But we really have more to offer than the brands you are very familiar with. For the past two decades, we have been building a strong reputation in the nutrition business as well. We have juices such as Tropicana and the Naked Juice, and protein smoothies. And we have Advantage Sports Nutrition with the brands like Gatorade. And we have the healthy breakfast product like Quaker Oats and also a selection of hummus dips with the Sabra brands. And we also have a huge dairy portfolio, especially in Russia. But as the company's first senior vice president of Senior Vice President of Nutrition R&D in PepsiCo, I'm quite excited about my role, and I really would like to share with you what we are doing in PepsiCo. It's my privilege to work daily with our commercial partners and 2,000 of the colleagues in R&D PepsiCo to develop more nutrition products for you and for all of our consumers. And for the next few minutes, I would like to tell you about the transformation journey we have been on at PepsiCo to help the company's business. A decade ago, our R&D division was really in the go-do mode. If a product was popular, the sales and marketing teams at PepsiCo would tell us to go create a line extension or a new flavor or package. And they would just ask us, can you make a potato chip with a sour cream or an onion flavor? And we would go and do that. Can you make a potato chip with vinegar and salt? And then that's what we would do. We were kind of a short order restaurant cooks, but with PhD as a background. And to be fair, this model really worked well for decades and enabled sustainable growth for the company. But the world changed, as we have heard yesterday and this morning, and we all are very much familiar with, and also so did the consumer. When the internet arrived and people everywhere began communicating with each other in new ways, things really changed. Consumers began to demand much more from the food and beverage companies, as we all are aware. They want more nutrition. They want less sugar. They want less salt. They want less fat. They want more relevance, a stronger connection with the brands, and they also want more transparency. And that's when we realized that the one-size-fits-all strategy that really guided our success for the last decades really would not guarantee any more success for the next 50 years to come. If we wanted to be a global powerhouse, we needed to create different products for people with different needs and different preferences. So at PepsiCo R&D, we knew it was time to fundamentally and radically disrupt ourselves. And the goal was really simple. We had to transform our company's go-do R&D function. We had to make R&D a driver of the business and not a follower anymore. The goal may be simple, but really shaking up R&D function was a hard thing to do. And let me tell you for the next couple minutes what we did do to get where we are right now. First, we complemented a great team that we had with new people with new capabilities, really bring in much more diversity. And we added PepsiCo experts from people with a very diverse background like agronomy, exercise physiology, rheology, computational biology, and other fields, really to bring the diversity of thought. My boss, Dr. Mahmoud Khan, he came from the, he's a medical doctor, and he was appointed as head of R&D. And in the years that followed, many people, including myself, joined the company. The second big change that we made was that really to go into a new research direction. An R&D function that focused for decades on the consumer's taste experience now began to focus on a lot more. We began to focus really on the entire body. We began to study the consumer's preference drivers, things like taste, aroma, and texture. And we began paying much more attention to the visual messages of our foods and beverages. We wanted to gain a much deeper understanding of the importance of convenience for the consumer. And by expanding our research scope, we were convinced it would help us to deliver much more of the right products. Let me repeat, this was really a big change in the way our the way our R&D team had worked in the past. And in the same way our scientific colleagues in the pharma company seek to discover breakthrough treatments, we wanted to discover and design and develop foods and beverage products that could deliver enjoyment and provide nutritional benefits. The third action that we did do is in our transformation journey was really to develop a new strategy. For decades, we were focused on products. Products was really what we were focusing on. But now we said, on top of focusing on products, we also will focus on platforms. Instead of doing hundreds or even thousands of small products for every individual country, our goal today is to do a few things very big, very broadly, and on an incremental basis. The objective is really to leverage the scale across the markets and platforms, to accelerate the commercialization timing, and to leverage our existing footprint and reduce complexity, which is very critical for a huge company as we are. Next, we also created a new structure at PepsiCo. And we used to be a decentralized organization, and now we are a globally aligned, much more flexible and a responsive organization. Instead of organizing ourselves by geography, basically every important country had its own R&D department, focusing on developing products for that specific country. We now are organized by categories, and so across beverages, snacks, and nutrition. So if you work on snacks, your team is not only in Texas, where we have the center of gravity for our snacks business, but also Mexico or the UK or Shanghai, we have people working on snacks being part of the snacks organization. And likewise, for the beverages, we have the people in Ireland or in New York or the Middle East. And so that's how we are organized. The fifth action that we took was also to expand our global R&D footprint. We evolved really from a US-based and focused R&D operation to a much more globally diverse function. We did this by opening R&D centers of excellence across the world. And our centers of excellence in the UK focus on agro and especially the snacks. In Germany we do fruit and vegetables, dairy we do in Russia, baked products we do in Mexico, grains we do in Chicago. And our second biggest R&D facility outside the US is here right in Shanghai. This center really was opened only in 2012, and it's a state-of-the-art facility and PepsiCo's largest center outside the US. It's dedicated to innovation for both foods and beverages. Shanghai is a hub of new product packaging and equipment innovation for PepsiCo business globally. So it's not only serving here this area, we also develop the products for across the world. The facility is equipped with an advanced culinary center, and of course the people focus on developing and customizing the food and products for taste preferences really here in this region. The final stage of our transformation occurred when we really explored, of course, also new ways of opening up our organization. We used to be an organization doing most of our work to develop the new products in-house. But in the last couple of years, we really have signed more than 50 dedicated agreements with specific partners to really develop the innovations for the future. Partnerships with companies, suppliers, universities, all different ways tailored to what we want to achieve. So a lot of changes. And the question is, what did all those changes at PepsiCo mean for the company and for the consumer? Well, I can tell you it was a lot. So. We broadened our portfolio. We have an expanded range of fun for you products, better for you products, good for you products. But also these changes had a big impact on our company and the R&D teams. PepsiCo now the nutrition brands, as you can see, in the mostly the good for you products account for more than 20% already of the sales portfolio, and it is growing as we speak. And inside PepsiCo, R&D is no longer seen as a go-do organization. We are now an innovative go-to function that drives the top line as well as the bottom line growth. We got now a seat at the table with the business and the supply chain, and we jointly are setting the objectives. We are not just executing what we are asked to execute. So as a result, at PepsiCo R&D, we went from being kind of short order cooks to 4-star chefs who anticipate what the customer and the consumer really want. And the result of this transformation is also visible in the marketplace, where we are really on an innovation winning streak. In the US, 10 out of the top 50 new food and beverage products introduced last year were PepsiCo products, and that's up from 9 in 2013. In 2013, we had 6 new products that had $100 million revenues already. Products like Mountain Dew Kickstart that already had $100 million in the first year, and today already have grown to over $300 million. And in fact, innovation has gone up to 9% of our revenue. So it basically means every year we have about $6 billion revenue coming from sales that we did not have in the past, year after year after year. And that number, that percentage is up from 7% where it used to be. So as you can see in the marketplace, our R&D organization is creating a competitive advantage gap for the company. And the gap widens as our company continues to innovate and reinvest in R&D. As I mentioned earlier, one of our key priorities today is to migrate from products to platforms and to leverage our size and scale and at the same time satisfy consumers in diverse geographies. And the way we do this is to develop a great platform in one of our global R&D hubs, and then we quickly export it and customize the brand for local taste. We call this also our global strategy, a global offering made locally relevant. And let me give you two examples of that. Let me start with an example from the snacks business, the Ruffles Deep Rich Potato Chips. It's also known as what people say, the crunch heard around the world. The product was not just a line extension, instead it was really the potato chip fundamentally reimagined by PepsiCo. And we had to crack a code to do so. We had to figure out how to design a thin and heartier chip. And we discovered a solution using a combination of deep consumer insight and technology. So it's not only R&D, it's one of those examples, it's clear. It's really the joint efforts of the different functions in the company. And next, we leveraged the technology to design the chip. We designed a new three-dimensional chip using 3D printing and computer modeling. We built our own proprietary slicer. We filed for patents. And after we built the chip, our chefs really customized the flavors to really satisfy local taste. And to give you a sense of how we leverage skill today, if this chip had been introduced 25 years ago, right now it might have been on the market in 2-3 places. But today, only 3 years after the first introduction in the US, right now, this 100 million brand is already available in 25 countries. So very quick rollout across the world, at least versus how we used to do that. Let me give you another example from the nutrition field. Quaker oats. Oatmeal, as you know, has a deep tradition in the West. It's for goodness, it's for good health, it's for satiety. It's a great way to start the day. But oatmeal also can be bland, and it was a burden to cook. And our job in R&D was to modernize oats. How can we make a nutritious breakfast food fun and easy to consume? Our job was really to reinvigorate the grains consumption. And that's just what we did with our Quaker Real Medleys brand. It's another global platform that we have made locally relevant around the world. And the current line includes Real Medleys hot cereals in convenient cups. It's the ready-to-eat cereals. It's the oatmeal with 50% less sugar. It's the 3-minute steel-cut oatmeal that is much faster versus the 30 minutes that we used to have. It's the super grains, it's the instant oatmeal. So a whole range of products really customized for the different countries, but all based on the same platform. Well, another dimension of our transformation is the efforts to advance the human sustainability. And sometimes I think about my job developing medicines in pharma is like my job developing nutrition brands at PepsiCo. In both jobs, in the end, the goal was and is to help people and animals live better. But if I had to tell you the biggest difference between the jobs, it's this. At a pharma company, the consumer expects you to come up with a product that does not taste good. But of course, in the food and beverage world, if the consumer wants to get, if you are going to develop a product and if it does not taste great, you won't have a consumer. And this is one of the reasons why I'm lucky to have my job, because every new product that my team makes, I get to taste. And clearly that was not the case in my previous jobs. And in the end, that is the biggest challenge that we in R&D nutrition and in R&D PepsiCo we face. How to develop foods and beverage products that offer more nutrition, more convenience, more quality, without sacrificing the taste. And I'm proud to say that at PepsiCo, our scientists have made great progress against those goals. Today, we are reducing sugar and salt and fat content across the entire portfolio. And at the same time, we are still protecting the taste. With our Fun for You and Better for You offerings, we have made significant progress based on major technology breakthroughs by the R&D teams involved. We remove more than 3,000 metric tons of sodium from the total food portfolio since 2006, and we removed approximately 22,000 metric tons of fat from saturated fat from key global food brands between 2006 and 2012. And in sugar, we even removed 370,000 metric tons of sugar from the total beverage portfolio in the US since 2006. So when we talk about beverages, 15 years ago, less than one quarter of the sales came from zero or low calorie beverages. And today, that is close to 50%. 50% of the beverage portfolio is based on low or mid-calorie products. And by balancing the choices we offer consumers, we have lowered the average number of calories per serving by more than 15%. It's now only 65 calories per serving. And as you can imagine, we are continuing this path. We are working to accelerate these trends to really take out more of the fat and the salt and the sugar. As I showed you, R&D investment, at least in PepsiCo, has been quite successful. And the investment really have gone up with more than 35% since 2011. It's really paying off in the company in a big way. Today we have $22 billion brands in the portfolio, and that's the direct result of the innovation path that we have pursuing for the last decades. And in fact, we have even grown this number of billion-dollar brands by 30% since 2006. And apart from those, we also have a whole range of products between the $250 million and $1 billion brands, all showing successful innovation. And these successes really are making it an exciting time to work at PepsiCo R&D. On the one end, we have the tailwind of the mega trends that we all are familiar with that are asking for new products with enhanced nutritional profiles. And on the other end, we see major progress in food technologies. These advances help us create new products, new processes, new packages. And also these technologies will help us to further reduce salt, sugar, and fat, and enhance the nutritional profile of the products. Furthermore, right now there are more than ever opportunities to start partnerships and really leverage the external capabilities and funding. And finally, there is indeed the commitment of the PepsiCo leadership that does believe in growth via innovation and accelerate and is prepared to invest in that. So overall, R&D in PepsiCo, we are inventing the company from the inside. And we are delivering on today's business priorities, because it's clear that, you know, on the day-to-day we have our role to play to deliver what we are expected to deliver. And at the same time, we are creating opportunities for sustainable growth, incremental growth in the future. So let me leave it here, and we can.
Hello?
Yeah. Do you have any question? 有提问吗?
So as you introduced, PepsiCo has a lot of brands in your portfolio. So how would you define the pace and rhythm for the innovation on each individual brand?
Well, this As you know, I've been working in different industries, and I can tell you this is an industry with a relatively high pace of innovation, certainly as compared to pharma, where you have projects and innovations that will take a decade. But also here, we are working on products and building platforms that can take years to before they really transform into products. So I would say we have the whole range of opportunities. We have the simple, what you could call refresh, where you know it is relatively simple to make a change in a product, and it's a couple of months up to really multi-year projects that of course need to be planned very well before they translate in a real new product. So the rhythm is really very diverse.
My first question is, I'm a big fan of Lay's, in particular the cucumber flavor. You talked about the deep-fried potato chips. And if it is deep-fried, it means that the surface area is going to be bigger. Does it mean that you have to put more seasonings like salt and sugar on the surface of the potato chips? When you design new structures, new forms, how could you balance this issue? Because people want to have less salt and less sugar, so how would you approach that question?
Yeah, that is indeed a fair question. So indeed, the taste is, and the advanced profile is coming from the enhanced surface. That is correct. And then the amount of salt and sugar and fat, we basically define first by doing the taste experience, and then over time we reduce the salt over time.
Okay, 谢谢您的问题。
Thank you for your answer.